Well, good evening. I'm Debbie Walsh, and I'm the director of the Center for American Women and Politics at the Eagleton Institute of Politics, and it is really my deep pleasure to welcome you all here tonight. We're pleased that so many of you are joining us for this program, and perhaps it's because many of you heard about tonight's event from our co-sponsors for tonight, and you can find all their names listed in your program, and I'd like to thank each of them for their participation. I'd also like to do a special thanks to Jackie Litt, the Dean of Douglas Residential College, the Women's College of Rutgers University, for letting us have our event here tonight on her campus. So thank you very much, Jackie. I also want to take a minute to introduce the director of the Eagleton Institute of Politics, Ruth Mandel. None of this would be possible without Ruth. Ruth was the founding director of the Center for American Women in Politics. Now, as many of you know, tonight's program was made possible by the generous support of the New Jersey legislature for the Senator Wynona Lipman Chair in Women's Political Leadership. The chair honors the first African-American woman in the state Senate. She represented Essex County for 27 years in the New Jersey legislature. And over those years, she became the strongest and most consistent voice in the legislature for women and minorities. She was the legislature's leading advocate on behalf of children, families, low-income people, small businesses, and people with AIDS. She tackled issues including employment discrimination, marriage law, child support, sexual assault, domestic violence, and the rights of children. Senator Lipman also taught at Essex County College and was a great supporter of New Jersey's community colleges. What's most striking is that for many of her years in the Senate, she was the only woman there. She was always speaking up for those with the least access to the political process, always alert to the political implications of race and gender. And if you'd like to know more about this amazing woman, you can read a full bio of her on our website, and there's a little bit about her and the chair on the back of your programs. Through the legislature's continuing support for the Lipman Chair, we have been able to bring an extraordinary roster of distinguished women to Rutgers to inspire us, and tonight is no exception. In addition to supporting this lecture series, Lipman Chair funds support Essex County residents attending COP's Ready to Run program and community college students who participate in New Leadership. Both programs are very much in keeping with Senator Lipman's interest in empowering more women to lead. There are lots of honored and special guests here tonight, and I'm not going to introduce all of them. There are just a few that I want to take a moment. One of them that I can't not introduce is former Governor Jim Florio. Thank you so much for being here, Governor. We also have a distinguished advisory committee that aids us in implementing the Lipman Chair, and I'd like to thank the members of that group who are here tonight. Kathy Crotty was here. She had to leave. I think Kathy did leave, but she is the former executive director of the New Jersey Senate Democrats and a longtime colleague of Senator Lipman, and in many ways, the person who first kind of conceived of this idea of how could we honor Senator Lipman. So I want to thank her in absentia. Sandra DeGeneste, who is here. Where's Sandra? Oh, terrific. Sandra is Senator Lipman's niece, and we are very grateful for all the support that you have given us over the years on this project. Alma Saravia, who worked with Senator Lipman for many years, is the executive director of the Commission on Sex Discrimination in the Statutes, and who wrote a wonderful blog post for us, I hope you'll go and look at it, about Senator Lipman. It really is a wonderful memorial to her. So, Alma, thank you. And Maria Vizcarando, who is a longtime friend of the center, but also a longtime leader in Essex County and Newark, and who really counted Senator Lipman as her mentor and her friend. Maria, thank you for your help and support. And of course, State Senator Nia Gill. Senator Gill is a longtime friend of COP, and I've asked her to actually introduce our speaker this evening. She is a practicing attorney as well as a lawmaker. Earlier in her career, Senator Gill worked for Wynona Lipman as her legislative aide, and maybe she'll share with us some of the other jobs she did for Senator Lipman. Later, she followed in the senator's footsteps, and she has served in the state Senate since 2002, representing the 34th District. She's currently Senate President Pro Tem. She chairs the Commerce Committee and is the Vice Chair of the Judiciary Committee. She served in the Assembly from 1994 to 2001. And throughout her service in Trenton, she has forcefully championed many of the same issues as Senator Lipman did. Indeed, many of the same issues that our speaker tonight covers as a journalist. So it is a great pleasure and an honor for me to introduce the introducer, Senator Nia Gill.
Well, thank you very much. And to our speaker, Michel Martin, thank you, Debbie, and to the Center for Women in Politics. I started out with Senator Lipman as the babysitter for Will and Karen. Senator Lipman, of course, was in Montclair. She came from Greenwich Village, and I thought that was just too hip. She had taught Martin Luther King French. And Montclair used to be a bastion of Republican power. And Senator Lipman organized the community, and we know that from the PTA, she became our political leader. And in 1971, Wynona Lipman became the first African-American woman selected to serve in the New Jersey State Senate. During her almost 30 years of service in the Senate, she fundamentally transformed the use of power to address the issues of women and children. When I came to the Assembly, Senator Lipman had been fighting for 14 years for needle exchange. We were one of the highest in the nation of women of color with HIV and AIDS. We were one of the highest rates of pediatric AIDS among children of color. And when I came to the Senate, to the Assembly, Senator Lipman said, "Baby, this is a fight that we're going to fight together, and this is a fight that we must win." We fought the fight in the Assembly, and thereafter, Senator Lipman died. I was then elected to the Senate, and I said, "Right, Senator Lipman, this is a fight that we're going to fight, and we're going to win." And Senator Lipman taught me how to use power. And so because, you know, Senator Lipman was a little more traditional, but I have to run off the line against the party, I decided to use the power of senatorial courtesy, because senatorial courtesy had always been used traditionally for the privileged, the politically connected, and the wealthy. And so I decided to use political power to get my votes for needle exchange. And so for 2 years, I refused to sign off on the things that were necessary with respect to senatorial courtesy. And you know I took a beating. I took a beating in the newspaper. I took a political beating. And at the end of the day, after 2 years, when all the rich, the privileged, and the powerful could not do what they wanted to do without senatorial courtesy, I then was able to get the votes And when we, and at that time, African-American women and women of color, highest in the nation, HIV and AIDS. But because of who they were, no one was willing to come forward for that fight. And so Senator Lipman's legacy reverberates through the halls of Trenton. Every time we fight for equality, every time we fight for access, every time we stand up to an overreaching governor, Wynona is there with us. She taught an entire generation of legislators that we can be an instrument of individual and collective transformation. If you really want to stand out from the crowd and be recognized by society, Senator Lipman said, then it is the quality of the contribution which you make to others that counts. And Ms. Martin is here tonight because she continues Senator Lipman's legacy. She stands out from the crowd. She speaks truth to power. She asks questions that many dare not ask, and she adds an important voice to the dialogue on issues that affect us all. Ms. Martin, a native of Brooklyn, graduated from Radcliffe College at Harvard University. She has spent more than 25 years in journalism, joining NPR in 2006 to launch Tell Me More, a one-hour daily NPR news and talk show that aired from 2007 to 2014. She now can be heard across NPR news programs, a skilled reporter, an interviewer whose topics on any given day would be education, families, faith, race, or social issues. Prior to her time at NPR, Ms. Martin worked at ABC News for a decade. She served as a correspondent for Nightline, reporting on such subjects as the congressional budget battles, the United States Embassy bombing in Africa, racial profiling, and the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina. She was part of the network's award-winning coverage of September 11th and contributed to a documentary on Anita Hill, Clarence Thomas controversy. A critically acclaimed AIDS special in reports for the ongoing series America in Black and White. She also reported for the ABC News magazine Day One, winning an Emmy for her coverage of the international campaign to ban the use of landmines, and was a regular panelist on This Week with George Stanopoulos. Before joining ABC, Ms. Martin covered state and local politics for the Washington Post and national politics and policy at the Wall Street Journal. While she was a White House correspondent, she has also been a regular panelist on the PBS series Washington Week and a contributor to Now with Bill Moyers. Needless to say, Ms. Martin is an extremely accomplished journalist. And every day, she lives her life as part of the ever-evolving struggle for women, for justice, and for people who seek the truth. Today, Michel Martin joins the company of accomplished, powerful warrior women, including Shirley Chisholm, to serve as Senator Wynona Lipman's chair in women's public leadership. To our sister in the struggle, I introduce Michel Martin.
Thank Debbie, I'm not sure you did me a favor by making me follow Senator Gill. Thank you for that amazing introduction, Senator, and for your important work. Thank you, distinguished guests, Governor, it's an honor for you to come. Thank you, and Dean, thank you, the advisory group. Thanks to Debbie Walsh and Ruth Mandel for their important work, from which I have benefited greatly throughout my career as a journalist. And thank you to all those connected to the Center for American Women in Politics at the Eagleton Institute and all those who were responsible for bringing me here today. And thank you all for coming, because I know you could be watching The Voice or or The Walking Dead. It is quite an honor and rather intimidating to be following the likes of White House thought leaders Melody Barnes and Valerie Jarrett, Congresswoman Eleanor Holmes Norton, and Congresswoman, perhaps not for much longer, Donna Edwards, the distinguished journalists Gwen Ifill and Michelle Norris, whom I'm pleased to call both colleagues and friends, to name just a few of the distinguished guests who have previously offered this address in honor of the late Senator Wynona Lipman. It is intimidating just thinking about it. And for encouragement, I thought of the ancestors. Among many people of the world, there is the belief that the ancestors don't ever leave us, that they are actually right here with us, that they just take on another form. I think of something I heard from someone whose opinion I value greatly, the director of the Smithsonian Museum of African Art, Janetta Besh Cole. She says there is an African proverb. It said that if you lift up the name of your ancestor, that person will never die. If you lift up the name of your ancestor, that person will never die. So in that spirit, in this place, I lift up the name of Shirley Chisholm, who was unbought and unbossed. I lift up the name of Fannie Lou Hamer, who was sick and tired of being sick and tired. I lift up the name of Harriet Tubman, who freed 1,000 slaves and said, "I could have freed 1,000 more if only they knew they were slaves." Last, but certainly not least, I lift up the name of Evelyn Wynona Moore Lipman, who said, and I know you know it, "If you want to create change, don't just get to know important people, become important people." That's it. Truly, one of the great things about this invitation, certainly it is not the balmy weather, was the chance to get to know more about Senator Lipman. I was very interested to learn that not only was she the first African-American woman in the New Jersey State Senate when she was elected in 1971, she was often the only woman serving in the Senate and at times the only African-American, and somehow she became the longest serving member of the state Senate. Now let's think about this. Remember, this was just 5 years after Fannie Lou Hamer and the other activists formed the Mississippi Freeman Democratic Party to challenge the seating of the all-white delegation at the Democratic Convention because of that state party's ongoing involvement in not only suppressing the black vote, but refusing even to profess loyalty to the Democratic nominee because of his support for civil rights. This was 5 years after that, and this was after Fannie Lou Hamer was viciously beaten by the police in her own home state, acting under color of law, for the crime of trying to register to vote and to get others to register to vote and educating herself and participating in voter education projects as a citizen. And her legal efforts were supported by a very young Yale Law School graduate named Eleanor Norton, who, as in the manner of the universe, came to speak to you here. And as a former State House reporter myself, I was not surprised to learn, although I was amused, to learn from one of her biographies that at the time that she was elected, the New Jersey State House did not have a restroom for women, so that a state trooper would have to stand guard outside the men's room when she used it. Talk about the way the world changes, right? I was also interested but not surprised to learn from the biography that Debbie told me about that I read in preparation for this lecture that her political career came about almost by accident. Some might call that providence. but it was certainly not the profile of the kid who was planning his ascent from the time of his election to sixth grade president. I mean, how could it have been? I mean, she was born in 1923 in the apartheid South. She went on to study French at Talladega College, Tulane University, and Columbia University, President Obama's alma mater, as it happens, and the Sorbonne in Paris, where she met her future husband, a man she would not have been able to legally marry in her own home state. Now, I understand from her biography that she had some difficulty getting a college teaching position in her field, although she had a doctorate. And I'm sure there were all kinds of fake reasons that people gave for not giving her a chance, including perhaps the fact that she had kids. But honestly, what intrigued me most about her, and this is not an original thought, but I can't think of any other way to say this, she was so far ahead of her time. I mean that in 1940, fewer than 2,000 African Americans in her home state of Georgia had a high school diploma, and she was already a college graduate and pursuing a graduate degree. At the time when interracial marriage was still against the law in her own home state, she chose as her partner a man not of her race or faith. She somehow figured out how to have a career and raise her family at a time when part-time professional work was not common or even tolerated. People forget it wasn't until 1974 that the Supreme Court ruled that teachers could not be denied maternity leave. You may or may not be shocked to recall it was routine practice for teachers in many jurisdictions to be forced to resign if they had children. And I think we should all thank Senator Gill for her role in helping that, make sure that Senator Lipman was able to practice. And Senator Lipman started her political career at the age of 49, a time when, as many of you have surely experienced, many women become invisible to the world. The fashion industry no longer cares about us. Entertainment and media industries have no use for us. And her arrival in politics did not come from pedigree or a spouse's prior career. It came from her own activism. As the first African-American, one of the first African-American PTA presidents in New Jersey, and one of her activities was to form a human mom chain around the playground when the town leaders insisted on using it to dump dirty snow. Now, the causes she undertook are almost quaintly mainstream now, but they certainly were not then, like getting services for people, as Senator Gill just reminded us, with HIV and AIDS, like increasing penalties for men who patronize underage prostitutes. It is only now that we are starting to get serious about the sex trafficking of minors as something that we don't just read about in some faraway place in the New York Times in the back of the section of the international news, but something happening right here, right now, under our own noses. In other words, she was ahead of her time, ahead of the curve. She was an outsider who somehow got inside. And that's what I wanted like us to notice today. History did not end in 1971 when Senator Lipman was elected. It's going on all around us all the time. We like to think as if history is something that happens to other people or something you visit in a museum, something far away, but it's not. It's funny to me that we so aggressively document the material changes going on all around us. So many people are so excited about and closely follow the moment when the new smartphone is coming out, or maybe even when the new LeBrons are coming out, or when the new Manolos are coming out. You can admit it. But we don't notice, or we only notice with fear and sometimes anger, when the people around us are changing. Why is that? This country is changing. It's always been changing. But the pace of change is as fast as it's ever been. In her address last year, or actually 2 years ago, sorry, former White House domestic policy strategist Melody Barnes talked about this, but let me pick up a little bit on what she talked about. Let me point you to a new study just out last month that was jointly sponsored by three different think tanks or, you know, policy institutes, with three different political persuasions, the American Enterprise Institute, the Brookings Institute, and the Center for American Progress. The study is called States of Change, the Demographic Evolution of the American Electorate, 1974 to 2060. It describes in a powerful way the country is changing. And if you're looking for a summary of this and you want to read this later, I'd point you to a column by Robert Samuelson in the Post op-ed page earlier this month, where he describes some of the study's main themes. Now, a lot of people know that the racial composition of the country is changing, and I will get back to that. But there are many other fault lines to consider. This country is getting older. Americans 50 and older are now a third of the population, up from one-fourth in 1960. Baby boomers are no longer the largest demographic group. That would be millennials, who were born from 1981 to 2000. Millennials are now 27% of the population. Boomers, 24%. We still slightly outnumber Gen Xers, who are about 21%. What does this mean? It means that no one demographic group is setting the tone for all others. It means that power is almost equally dispersed, or rather, the demographics are almost equally dispersed. Power is another thing, and we'll talk about that in a minute. The percentage of unmarried voters is something that has gone largely unnoticed and is rarely discussed. In 1974, 70% of eligible voters were married, 30% were unmarried. Now the split is almost 50-50. 52% married, 48% not, reflecting the fact, as many of you know, that many people marry later or not at all or dissolve their marriages at some point. And what you might not have noticed is what Samuelson called the gap between voters and the rest of the population. In 2012, slightly more than a quarter of voters were minorities. That's a fraction of the share of the population, which is now almost 40%. So what you have is a situation where a minority is making decisions for the majority with whom they do not necessarily see common cause. And when has that been a recipe for social harmony? Let's get back to that racial issue. In a lot of cities and towns, we can all look around and see how the country is changing. But what you might not know is how much and how fast. You might know that in 1980, 80% of the U.S. population was white, or considered itself white, let me put it that way. Now, it is 63%. By 2060, the white population is expected to be 44%. African Americans will remain about 12 to 13%. Asian Americans, and I apologize for this, that's how it is in the survey, others, are projected to double from 8% of the population now to 15%. Meanwhile, Latinos have gone from 6% of the population in 1980 to 17% now and are projected to reach 29% by the year 2060. Now let's talk about that part. Because one of the things we often don't notice is we use these broad sweeping terms, but even within these groups, there are wildly different variations, wild diversity that we hardly even acknowledge or even discuss. I mean, according to the Pew Research Center, the Latino population has increased sixfold since 1970, but this is not a monolithic group of people. The demographics vary wildly depending on where they came from and when they came. For example, Hispanics, Latinos of Mexican origin, have a median age of 25 compared to people of Cuban descent with a median age of 50. Did you know that 51% of Venezuelan immigrants have a college degree? That is a larger percentage than the general population. That's compared to 7% of people from El Salvador or Guatemala. Now, in his column, this is how Robert Samuelson saw this complexity. He said this is part of what explains the political paralysis in Washington. It's not, as the partisans would have it, necessarily Republican obstructionism or President Obama's arrogance, but to the fact that, quote, both parties have had a hard time creating agendas that appeal across ideological, racial, and ethnic lines. There's been a fragmentation of power and purpose that transcends the defects of political leaders. Now, he goes on to give a dire warning. He says the central problem of American governance is how to create a political system that advances the nation's long-term interest, even though politics may be dominated by groups pursuing their short-term self-interest. Power may derive from the people, but it has to be tempered, in Samuelson's words, in ways that allow for the future. This is a challenge every generation faces, and one, he says, that we are arguably failing, unquote. But that is why it is so important to bring the outsiders in, because they are already here. We cannot deny the truth of our eyes. We could, but where is it getting us? This is, in my view, why we have to talk about this. When I and my colleagues started Tell Me More, our agenda was not to sit around staring in the mirror and congratulating ourselves on being diverse, but rather to create a place and space to talk about how this country is changing and how it affects all of us. Now, I'm not going to go and rehash NPR's decision to cancel the program, which I've made clear I regret and disagree with. But you might note that the New York Times similarly just decided to redeploy a correspondent who is also doing similar work. And I find it fascinating that the decision to focus on these issues as a coverage area comes and goes in the so-called mainstream media, the legacy news media. But we have all kinds of shows that focus on technology. We have all kinds of shows about changing your house and rearranging your house and how to throw out all your old stuff and what's in your closet, but remarkably little discussion about who is living in this country and what we all want and don't want and how we should proceed in an era when there is not one dominant lifestyle or value system dictated by one ethnic group or generation. This is puzzling to me. It is also interesting to me that the entertainment media is taking all this on. Why is there more diversity on Scandal than there is on the evening news? The future is here now, and if we continue to refuse to allow for a language that allows us to acknowledge these differences in the real world and not just in TV land to figure out how to talk about these issues, I don't know what we're going to do. Now, I'm not an expert on this, but I will submit that that is one of the reasons I am both a journalist and a talk show host. Now, I'm dating myself here, but one of my favorite quotes is from the biography of Russell Baker, whom some of you will remember was a much-loved columnist for the New York Times, and he wrote a wonderful memoir called Growing Up about when he was a rookie reporter trying to peel some information from a desk officer who didn't feel like giving it to him, and one of the crusty old sergeants rolled by and asked what was happening, and when he heard, he finally told the other guy, he said, give the kid what he wants. Not telling him about it didn't make it unhappen. I don't know about you, but it seems that too often that there is a default about not talking about the changes we see in front of us, and somehow not talking about it is going to make it unhappen. Or to put it another way, perhaps there is a default that minimizing differences instead of acknowledging and working through them is somehow in the service of unity. But what I find instead is that we mistake capitulation and domination for negotiation. What I find instead is a tendency to try to subsume a lot of people's truth in the service of a few people's fictions about the world. What I find instead is a willingness to ignore a lot of people's pain in the service of a few people's peace of mind. I don't think that's peace. I don't think that's truth. I don't think that's productive. Now, thank you, I'll take that. Now, do I think we need to sit around all day picking at each other's ancient wounds? I do not. I fully recognize that that is exactly what some people think journalists do, and that is exactly why they don't like us very much. Nor am I advocating that we really engage in an endless game of competitive suffering, where everybody competes over their victim status. I don't believe in that either. But what I am talking about is getting serious about noticing the truth of our world and having some actual conversations about how we want to face the future. I hold all of us responsible. I don't think it's just Mr. Obama's responsibility or Mr. Boehner's responsibility or Mr. McConnell's or Mrs. Clinton's. It is all of ours. We can all have necessary conversations, hard conversations as necessary. And that doesn't mean sitting around being a jerk or a know-it-all or one of these people who's always calling somebody out. But it does mean creating an environment where we demand greater truth and realism about the world. Here's an example. A few years ago, there was a deep dive study into African Americans and their thoughts about life, and it yielded such variation in answers to questions about lifestyle and opinion that one writer writing about the study questioned whether African Americans should even be considered a single ethnic group anymore. For example, African Americans are right down the middle, split almost 50-50 on issues like same-sex marriage and the death penalty. But you would not know that from the way black people are routinely portrayed and described, as if there were secret meetings to describe what they should think and do. And those who depart from these orthodoxies are described in almost heroic terms, as if they were all Joan of Arc about to be burned on the stake. That's a nice story, except that it's not true. Black people have many common experiences and many distinct ones, which lead them to conclusions about politics and life that make sense to them and upon which they act. Guess what? Just like everybody else. But somehow that nuance gets lost, and I consider it my job to restore complexity to those conversations. And I would like to enlist you in that effort. Now, in the time that we have left, and I hope we will all talk together, I'd like to humbly offer you some tips from my world to get those conversations started. I don't want to devalue my own currency, but I'll have to be honest with you, what I do is not rocket science. Having hard conversations and necessary conversations start because somebody wants to have them and other people agree. I take my cue from the great Julia Child. I had the privilege of interviewing her toward the end of her life, and I made the mistake of calling her a chef. And she said, "I'm not a chef." And I said, "Well, what do I call you?" And she said, "I am a cook and an eater." And in that spirit, so are you. All of us can be cooks, and all of us are eaters. Some of us will be better at it than others, but so what? We all need food to live. And I argue that the same is true of other necessary conversations. We all need to have them. And the more of us have them, the more necessary they will become, and the more essential that will become to having productive conversations in the public sphere, which too often revert into shouting message, or as I said before, competitive suffering campaigns. So how do we do this? And I offer you this in the humble spirit of somebody who just happened to have a lot of conversations day in and day out over the last few years. So these are my tips for getting started. First, be a person who wants to have one. No conversation begins unless somebody starts it. So be that person. Does it have to be about world peace? No, it does not. Can it be about the fact that you were asked to make calls to the Alumni Association and you happen to notice that all the names on your list seem to share your own ethnic group and you wonder what that's all about? Be the person who has that conversation. Second, listen as much as you talk. And yes, I do note the irony in the fact that I am the one standing up here talking today. But I have to be honest with you, I'm always amazed and sort of slightly chagrined when people ask me to talk, because the truth of it is, most of my job is actually listening. But I realize that would have made for a very boring evening if I were just to stand up and do that. But in the real world, I assure you that I listen as much as I talk. And that is something that all of us can do. Does that mean letting people walk all over me and my values? No, it does not. One of those values is clarity and civility. And yes, I insist on those. When conversations fall beneath that standard, you deal with it. When you find people falling into easy tropes and stereotypes that don't make sense, whether about gays or straights, whether about the religiously committed or the relentlessly secular, don't just sit there. Make trouble. Make good trouble, as John Lewis would say. Know that this is hard work. Know that this is hard work. We do ourselves a disservice when we do not acknowledge the difficulty of trying to bridge difference. Now, I can't remember now whether it was Leanne Hansen or Neil Conan who taught me this. They were both terrific longtime NPR hosts who I both considered mentors to me. One of them said, "You know what your reward is for doing a great show? You get to come back tomorrow and do another one." That's your reward for doing the hard work of trying to bridge across differences. You get to come back and do it again. The other advantage of that is you get to come back and do it again. Perfection is not possible. I've messed up more times than I could recount here. In fact, we could have a very interesting conversation just about all the times I messed up. Like, there's the time, and I tell people this story just because I want them to know that I really can't be that stupid. There was the time that I thought it would be really fun to have a pound cake making contest. It was Ramadan. there was the time when I ordered a Passover lunch in honor of my Jewish staff, and the chicken soup came filled with noodles, and the roast beef came on rye bread. That was only two of the occasions. I'll just, like I say, I could be... On a professional side, there are times when you say things wrong. I've said things wrong. I've had brain freezes. There was the time when I forgot how many days are in Hanukkah. This from a person who grew up in New York, lives next door to a synagogue, and buys the chametz every Passover. I just had a brain freeze. So perfection is not possible, but your reward for trying is you get to get up the next day and do it again. And my final word of wisdom, don't forget the sunscreen. In my time as a White House correspondent, we used to have this thing, some of you who've won White House correspondents know this, or correspondents know this, we had this thing called a pre-advance. When you'd go on a big trip, particularly an international trip, you would go and investigate the accommodations for your colleagues and come back and write a report. And I volunteered to go on a pre-advance to a summit in Barranquilla, Colombia. And I was excited about this. I was single at the time, did not have kids, and I volunteered in part because kidnappings were quite common then and security was a major concern. And as a person with no dependents, I thought it was my responsibility to go. I was quite proud of myself. I interviewed all the security team from the embassy, came back and got a full security briefing about what to do if you thought you were being followed. We get to the site of the summit, and my colleagues are turning redder and redder as the day goes on, because I forgot to tell them about the sunscreen. Because it wasn't my issue. All right, now I'm sure there's one dermatologist in here somewhere who's gonna say, yes, all skin can burn. I didn't know that then. We didn't know that then. So be the person. So the point of the story is, just because it's not your issue, doesn't mean it's not an issue. So don't forget the sunscreen. So be the person who wants to have the conversation. Listen as much as you talk. Know that it's hard work and you're gonna mess up, but do it anyway. Stay in the room. Don't forget the sunscreen. And most of all, remember your heroes and sheroes who went first so you don't have to. On my way up here today, I amused myself by thinking about who Senator Lipman would be if she were born here today and what she would be doing if she were on the scene today. I imagine she would still be ahead of the curve. I could easily imagine her with her French background as a celebrity chef. I know she'd be blogging. I can imagine her with one of those businesses that starts in somebody's kitchen and turns into Carol's Daughter or Spanx, and who does not love Spanx? And those of you who claim you don't know what that is, I don't believe you. Maybe instead of the state Senate, she might have been in the US Senate. Who knows? But I know that if she can do it, you can do it, I can do it. How do I know this? Because she was not a chef. She was a cook and an eater. And so are you. And so are we all. So thank you. So, Abby tells me that we can talk together now. Or you can just say something. We're all grown-ups. You don't have to ask a fake question. Just to stand up there, just because you want to say something. Yeah, go ahead. Hello.
Hello.
We're in your blue.
I just want to congratulate you.
Oh, thank you.
You're following in the footsteps of Sora Congresswoman Donna Edwards, and we are just so proud to have you as our new Lipman chair. And my question to you today is really around the negative images of women of color. My name is Dr. Denallery Johnson-Fennell. I'm the Social Action Chair and Partnership Chair for Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, Incorporated. And as you know, there are so many negative images of women, reality TV, all of these things that just put us in a bad light. My question is, how do we take our partnerships and connections with the NAACP, NOBLE, Truth and Reality, Black Girls Matter, all of these organizations that are talking about women's empowerment, and put that spin on it so that women in general are seen in the most positive light in the media? What are your recommendations?
Well, I think you would be better to answer that question than I, because that is your skill set and not mine. In terms of the representations, though, I will tell you that this is a great concern of mine. Mm-hmm. I have three daughters and a son, and to whom I claim, to whom I birthed. And it's interesting to see how quickly they become awash in this garbage that is that we are all swimming in without even really realizing it. I had the opportunity, I interviewed Shaquille O'Neal's mother and asked her about the reality show that her former daughter-in-law is involved in. And she told me that she was not in love with it either, but that there were, when the fighting stopped, you know, the ratings dropped.
Yes.
Who is watching those shows, since we all find them so disturbing? Someone is. And I dare say it would not shock me to discover that the majority audience for these shows are the people depicted on them. People of color, women of color. So I think one thing we can do is mind what's happening in our own homes and turn off the garbage and encourage our network to do similarly, because you know a fire does not exist without oxygen, and the people giving it oxygen are the same people who are affected by the consequences. It's not just girls I'm concerned about, I have to be honest with you. One of the more powerful stories that I reported on before Tell Me More went away was about a study, two studies that were published at the same time that described the fact that black boys are consistently perceived from the age of 10 as being older than they are. And this is a phenomenon that affects, seems to affect them uniquely, black girls as well. But in two different studies, with two different demographics, one group was young white women, aged 20 to 24, and the other study group was white police officers who were older, like in their 30s and 35, and they consistently misapprehended the age of these boys by a large factor. Consider the consequences of that. Acting up in a movie theater, and somebody thinks you're 15 and not 10, what the response is. Misbehaving in the street because you're tired and haven't had a snack, and somebody thinks you're 10 and not 5. Think about the consequences of that. So the reason I point this out is to say that it is not small. How we are viewed in the culture is not small. It does matter. And for people who say they don't see race, they don't see race. I think you do. I think you do. So I guess what I would say is, in terms of the activism piece, I don't feel that's my area of expertise. But in terms of validating for you that I do believe it matters, that I believe I can do. And but also I would say, too, is, you know, write the letter. You know, I know that, you know, I know that social media is such a complicated thing. Like, social media is filled with everybody from high school you couldn't stand, right? I mean, the bullies, the know-it-alls, the people who just can't wait to pick apart, like, this dumbest thing. But it does matter. It is powerful. And when you can persuade people that there are opinions out there that are different from the ones that are the ones that they're immediately presented with, it does matter. And in fact, there have been public campaigns that have, in fact, affected the continuation of certain entities and that have led to certain entities not being continued. The other thing I would point out is, and I think there's an op-ed project. I don't know, Debbie, if you guys were involved in this, but the op-ed project. I mean, to this day, the number of op-eds being presented in major media organizations by women is just a fraction of the total. I think it's something like 25%, which apparently is a huge increase from recent years where, I mean, I've seen studies that say only 10% of the people, are you going to tell me? Oh, no. I thought you were going to correct my number, and I was actually going to be happy to have that. But I'm just saying that, I mean, I think that women to this day only present or publish a tiny fraction of the opinion pieces published in major media. And that is something that any of you can do. And I'm not saying this is only an issue for women, and I hope you don't understand that. I think that people of goodwill who have thought about these issues deserve to be heard, but I do feel that there is a gross imbalance. There just is. And that is something that anybody in here, I guarantee you, is qualified to do. So I would commend those particular things to you. And as to the activism piece, that's why you all are here. Y'all gonna fix it.
We got it.
You all gonna fix it right here. You got it taken care of.
But the collective actions do matter, and I appreciate that.
They do matter.
Yes, thank you.
They do matter. Right.
Mm-hmm. Hi. So I'm a scholar at the Center for American Women in Politics, but I also teach college students. Mm-hmm. So I just want to, you know, you've been around the country and you've spoken to a lot of different groups about this very issue and about having these conversations. Mm-hmm. So I just wanted to know sort of about generational differences and if you've seen any things that work best with college students and how to sort of engage this generation in these hard conversations in a way that's productive and useful. Because I think as educators, that would be helpful for all of us.
You know, what I've observed is that I have observed a willingness to engage. I have not always observed a willingness to take it beyond that. Yeah. You know, I've observed a willingness to kind of get into a conversation, but the idea of showing up, picking a candidate, writing that person in, things like that. On the other hand, the incumbent president seems to have done that pretty well, hasn't he? I mean, he's figured out how to get people. It's not true that people won't get involved when they see a reason to get involved. I can tell you one of the things that I do in my events is make sure that young people are included, that not just as window dressing, but as participants. I mean, we just did an event in Dallas where we were talking about the ethics of football, and we included a high school football player as an equal partner in the conversation. We're doing an event in New Orleans, and we're talking about education. And you can better believe that we will have students as participants. But you know, this whole question of getting students involved, I'm fascinated. This is why I think I love memoir so much, because it reminds you that, you know, your problems are not, you know, have all been had. Everybody's had them. Like, I remember reading Dorothy Height. Do you remember the great Dorothy Height, one of the big six civil rights leaders? In fact, she was the only woman on the dais didn't have a speaking role at the March in Washington, which is a whole other story we could talk about. But in her memoir, she talked about being a youth. She first came into prominence as a youth leader, and she was complaining constantly about the youth voice isn't being heard. The youth voice isn't being heard. And finally, somebody said, "Okay, Dorothy, what do you want to say?" So I think that expecting people to be participatory and to take ownership of their stuff it's interesting to me. Oftentimes, you know, I get, as you would imagine, communicate with, you know, student journalists and people who are involved in student activism. And often one of the things that interests me is that they're doing other people's work badly, but not doing their own at all. Like, I find people who want to kind of advise me about, you know, what our trade policy with China should be. I said, but what about what's going on with education funding where you are? Yeah. Aren't you the expert on that? So, I mean, I think it's like any other. My principles for these conversations are no different, which is to say, be the one who wants to have the conversation. But that's one thing that, you know, we know that one thing, you know, with the grace of God, young people become not young people, and eventually things, you know, do change. But I agree with you that there is a great deal of potential. I'm very impressed with the organizing ability of the Gen X generation. I'm not as impressed to this point with the ability to channel that in certain directions. Like, I just read Fannie Lou Hamer's, a wonderful biography of Fannie Lou Hamer, And she talks about how important SNCC was to her. SNCC, which is Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, they were the ones going into the fields and getting people registered, and they were all kids. But when they were kids. I mean, they'll tell you that right now. They're not kids anymore, but they will tell you that we were kids. But when it came time to the ones who actually had to go and register and do those things, those people were all in their 40s and 50s. People forget this. Fannie Lou Hamer was 49 when she started. I mean, she wasn't, what, she was like 46 years old when she started her, they were all in their 40s and 50s. So, you know, I guess I would say that one of the other polarizations that I regret in our current environment is this generational polarization, where people act like if you're a millennial, you have absolutely nothing to say to, and if you're a boomer, you have absolutely nothing to say, when the reality of it is that no change happens unless everybody gets in it, or at least enough people get in it to move the ship. So I would say, you know, the same principles apply. Have the conversation, don't give up, and at some point, you know, they will get back their own. And they'll be complaining, these kids today don't do anything. They'll be just like, I can't believe the way they, all they do is want to fly around on their jetpacks all day.
Hi, my name is Brianna Grant. Yeah. I'm an Arcanet from the Gamma Nu Zeta chapter of Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated. And I am an aspiring journalist. And I was wondering, as an African-American woman, what makes you stand out more as a journalist?
It's showing up.
No, like, I mean.
Oh, you mean just in general? Oh, you didn't mean me. What do you mean makes you?
Like, what inspires you to make your mark, not just be a journalist, but to go above and beyond and get yourself out there?
Well, honestly, I must tell you, our business model is so broken that just showing up is often the best we can do. But you all are going to fix it. I know that. You all are going to fix it. I know you all you all are going to fix it. So, you know, I think everybody's got to figure out why they do what they do. I mean, I don't mind if people just show up as long as they're good at it. You know, really. I don't. And you can really have all the passion in the world, but if you lack skill, what good are you? So, and ethics, if I could point that out, if I could just throw that in there, ethics. discipline. I don't know. I mean, this is so much a part of one's belief system, like, that I would hesitate, honestly, to tell you mine, because some of that is private, and I don't want to impose my belief system on you. But I personally believe that our steps are ordered. And I personally believe that, you know, we all have a purpose, and part of our challenge is to find it. And I personally believe that it would be a betrayal of all of the people who sacrificed so much for me to be here with you today if I did not give my best efforts. That's what I believe. But you have to figure out what's going to motivate you. And I have every confidence that you will.
Thank you.
First of all, thank you for being here.
It's thank you
sad
for having
time,
me.
9 p.m. in my house when your show does not come on. Anymore.
Well,
but it is
always on
is.
Podcast. Podcast lives forever.
My name is Karen Alexander, and I'm just a person that's a citizen of the world. But I'm concerned about America as a world for some of the reasons that you mentioned, and I'd be interested in your perspective because you have a lot of positive energy, and I find myself despairing sometimes, quite honestly. About the notion that there could have been a post-racial America, when the reality is that Barack Obama's presidency has been the catalyst for race coming to the fore of many of these discussions and sometimes bad behavior.
I think that's a fair point. I think that's a fair analysis. I truly do. I mean, if you look at the, you know, polling data that says that many people say that they think race relations are worse now, but, you know, who says it that said, why do you cry peace, peace, when there is no peace? If the consequence of raising these issues is some people's discomfort becomes visible, does that mean those issues should never have been raised? If the consequence of disturbing a relationship means, if the price of your of comity is your dignity. Is that price worth paying? So, I mean, you know, history will judge this era as it has judged all others. And there have been many moments in history where one wishes things had been different. You know, my children are studying, they're in fifth grade, and they're studying the Civil War. And one of my kids, my daughter has taken to calling John Wilkes Booth the idiot. Because, and then the idiot did what he did, and everything got messed up. And I think that's a fair, you know, I was thinking, what would the world have been if a great leader like Abraham Lincoln hadn't died? But he did. And so we live in the times that we live in, and we have to meet the circumstances as they find us. But look at this room. Look at how integrated this room is. Look at how diverse, how many different kinds of people are in this room. Now, is every citizen of the world represented here? No. But are there a lot of different people here who aren't often in a room together? Yes. I think that's kind of exciting. I'm sure there are places, opportunities, let's say, in your world to make progress, and those are the opportunities that you have to seize. I mean, I can tell you that over the course of time doing my... Somebody really wants to get that hall clean, and I admire that. I respect that. That
everybody has a job.
Over the course of time, it's so interesting to me. You know, I'm irritated. I mean, obviously, I'm annoyed about my show being canceled. I've made that very clear.
And I applaud
however,
you for that.
Well, thank you. Or you could just... You should probably applaud the people who still continue to employ me, right? But... That show was founded in the middle of a recession. When we first went on the air, we went on online as an online entity. And you know how welcoming to women and people of color the online universe is, do we not? And we still, every year, had an increase in audience every single year. So I look at that and I say, and you know, even though this was a show that made a point of highlighting kind of intersections of, you know, ethnicity and gender and all those things, 75% of our audience was not of color. I know this from audience surveys. Do you know what that says? There are an awful lot of people out here who want to have these conversations. So have one. Have it. And it is true, and I think it is true, that these conversations do stimulate a lot of fear and anxiety on some people's part. I mean, I just think that for some people, their only understanding of themselves in the world is belonging to a dominant group. And when that idea is taken away, it has to be frightening. And so yes, it is true, for some people it will be very frightening. But not talking about this is like not talking to your kids about sex. Somebody's going to. So who do you want it to be? So I would argue that the people of goodwill, and they are not, I know, and they are clearly not all people of color, and all people of color are not of goodwill. There are people of color who can be just as sectarian and as narrow and as bigoted. I mean, let's just get real about that. Mm-hmm. Not just toward white people, but toward each other. So let's just get real about that and realize that, but there are also people who realize that our future is together. None of us is going. I don't know if you go. I'm not going any. Are you going? I'm not going. I haven't left the building. You aren't leaving, so at some point we are going to figure this out. And I do believe that if you create a context in which a certain kind of conversation is necessary, then leadership will meet that, in my opinion. I don't know, Governor, maybe, I don't know, you probably know more about this than I do. Fix it. Fix this thing right here. Fix it. So, go ahead.
One suggestion that sure. Eagleton might want to take advantage of this diverse audience, and it may not be appropriate within CAWP, but to facilitate the conversations, because my experience has been, even for Caucasian friends of 30, 40 years, this is not an easy conversation
no, it's
to
not.
Have. And only as a result of the events of the last 2 years is there the beginning to be some acknowledgement that maybe I was right, that racism isn't yet dead.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, I mean, people talk about this a lot when we have national issue, you know, things that surface and become part of national conversation. People say we need to have a national conversation about race. I confess I do not understand what that looks like. Is that, do you sell tickets? I mean, what is that? I don't get, what? Is it, like, what? I mean, real, here's my thing. Real conversations take place between people. Real mentoring takes place within the context of real work. And at the end of the day, I think, you know, seize the moment, and if there are things that need fixing, fix those things. You know, I mean, to me, it's like, you know how every spring you look at your house and think, oh my God, I gotta clean this place up, and you think, that's a mess, and so you sit down and eat a pizza because you think, I can't do that. But what you can do is get that kitchen drawer that it's a mess and fix that. And then you think, okay, well, the shelf, okay, I got the drawer, let me get the shelf. And then fix that. And then maybe you work your way around and you fix that. But what I'm saying to you is that this idea that there's going to be one moment, I mean, our history shows there is not that moment. It does not happen. But there are things that can happen, and those things can be real and are real. Because, I mean, look, I would not be standing here with you today if somebody, and you all, it's just most of us wouldn't be here today, because I don't know what any of your stories are, but I know that maybe one of y'all came over on the Mayflower, but two, three, but I'm sure a lot of us have stories that brought us here. And it was providence, it was luck, it was hard work, it was a combination of factors that brought us here. And those things are real. And similarly, whatever it is you do next is real, and it does matter. That's how I feel. So.
I was reluctant to ask this question a little bit because I'm worried about ungrateful given the history that you've documented. But one of the things that I've been thinking a lot about is fatigue and burnout. And I think I'm a person who talks to people, but my patience for talking to people is so much less than it used to be. If somebody, you know, if there's one new person who says to me, I'm colorblind or whatever, my irritation and my bitterness is so much bigger than it used to be. And it seems like you have what feels like a deep well of compassion and patience. And I'm interested in what you have to say about sharing those strategies.
You know, it's very nice of you to say that. Candidly, Debbie and I were just talking about this earlier. We all have that, don't we? We all have our deep wells of, we all have pools that we draw upon. And I thank you for that. You honor me. Honestly, you are my deep well of positive energy. You are. I mean, I do my work, and I get, you know, bombed by trolls calling me every name in the book, and then I get other people saying, go away, trolls, we really want to have this conversation, and this was of value to me in this particular way, and I'm sure you have a peer group in your life, and if you don't, then that's maybe a place to start, is finding a peer group of people who can help buoy you in this important work. I will say that everything is not for everybody at every point. So there might be a point at which it is best for you to not engage in these kinds of things. Everybody's got their point at which perhaps they need to shift gears. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Everything is not for everybody at every point. There was a point at which, for example, when we were covering the shootings at Newtown, and I have very small children, and there was a point at which I couldn't do it. And some of you, if you follow my work, then you may realize, you may remember that my brother took his own life I know exactly the moment and the day and the year. And I wrote about it once. I have been asked like every year to go to these survivor groups and to speak to these. I have never done it because I can't. I can't do it. And it is just not something I can, I don't have the, I can't. You can see right now I'm struggling to get it back just thinking about it. So everything is not for everyone at every point. And perhaps your energies would be better spent doing something else that's more restorative, because you cannot pour from an empty vessel. So that honestly, and I'm just speaking to you as like one person to another. I have no expertise at all. I'm just telling you how I don't have any studies. All I know is what works for me, and what works for me is common sense, people of goodwill, recognizing there are other people of goodwill, and recognizing that when it's time for you to step off and let somebody else do something, it's time for you to step off and let somebody else do something, and that really is okay. That's my take on it. So.
Thing that I wanted to say about the loss for me of Tell Me More was that it was the show that made me feel seen, and yeah. For that, thank you so much.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you.
Michelle, my name's Erica Hageman Robinson. I knew you way back.
I was wondering if I was like, I'm looking at it. And I was thinking, because I'm farsighted.
I'm delighted to have this forum to say what I want to say. Mm-hmm. I will just say that I lived in New Jersey many years, married a man from New Jersey, have taught in the public school system for 25 years, but met you when you were Michelle McQueen. Freshman. Year
Stupid.
At Harvard. We're both class of 1980.
Yeah.
And the little anecdote that I wanted to tell is actually, you know, speaking of things sort of working, moving in mysterious ways and synchronicity, when we met, we were in a dorm room, and it was our first night, and everyone was introducing themselves. Mm-hmm. And
am I going to like this story?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
You're scaring me a little.
You're going to like this story, Michelle.
Go ahead.
And everyone was going around the room and introducing themselves. And I knew that I had, I was there, so I figured I had some things to say. I left home at 16 and had worked for a few years and then put myself through Harvard. But there was a boy in the room, white, and he turned to me and he said, "Well, you know why you're really here, don't you?" And I, like a dummy, I said, "No, why?" And he said two words, affirmative action. And you tore him up one side.
Wow.
And you did that after there was a gap, because when he said that, after all I had been through and everything that I had achieved, when he said that, I couldn't, not only could I not think of anything to say, I put my head down. I think it's why I'm a teacher now, so that I can lift people's heads up. But in that moment, when I put my head down, you spoke for me. So I wanted to say thank you.
Oh, wow, thank you. Thank you. Well, thank you. That must have happened quite a few times because I don't remember. But thank you. You know, that is an interesting, thank you for that. Thank you for coming. And are you going to go to reunion? Yeah. Then we'd have to admit how old we are, which I'm not sure anyway, ma'am.
Thank you. My name's Michelle also, and you're the only Michelle I've ever met whose name is spelled the same.
Really?
Michelle. Yeah,
yay.
Yeah.
And, there's one more, my stepdaughter.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I can't claim responsibility.
Well, since we have the same first name, I have a question that I never knew who to ask this question of. I'm a news freak, so I get dressed for work in the morning, and I'm watching the news, and I get into the car, and I'm listening to the news. And in the morning, particularly on cold mornings, when I have the news on TV, and people are talking about important things, I look at the men, and I'm happy to see diversity in the newscasters. I look at the men, and they're there in their suits and their long-sleeve shirts, and it's 5 degrees outside, and all the women have sleeveless dresses on.
Yes.
And I know they're not all in menopause, you know. And I don't understand that. And it just brings that difference and that sexism. Yeah. I don't know. So I've never known who to ask. Why do so many women dress
well? I mean, you could you could blame the First Lady, right? Because, you know, it's a what can I say? I think what I would generally say about these issues is believe the truth of your eyes. Okay? And clearly, I need to hire a personal trainer because I...
I want to make a comment.
Sure.
I think one of the skills that you have is that you empower other people. And I think as women and the sprinkling of men in this room, we really could do one-on-one and empower each other. I talk to people when I'm waiting in line, or I talk to the person next to me when I'm waiting to hear a lecture. In fact, that's how I met Sylvia at a lecture in Princeton. So I think if we're not afraid to approach someone and say hi, you're waiting in line, have a conversation, you know? And I do it all the time, except one of my friends said, Toby, why are you doing that? Someone might not answer you. So I said, so they don't answer me.
Well, you know,
but
you
I'm
know,
having
you know,
the conversation.
You know, there are two kinds of people in the world, right? People who talk to people on airplanes and people who don't.
I talk to everybody.
And you can guess.
I met a lady who I'm still friendly with, yeah, who I talked to on a flight from Salt Lake City to Newark. We're still friends today.
That's wonderful.
So I think we need to reach out to other people. And I think you do that so well.
Well, thank you for that. Thank you. This last lady, if you don't mind, will be the last. This lady behind you in the pink. Thank you.
Thank you so much for the time. Ms. Martin, something that you said resonated largely with me, and that was don't forget the sunscreen. Just because it's not somebody's problem doesn't mean that it's not an issue. And I have sons. I have a 21 and a 19-year-old who are African-American and Latino, and so it's two against them, as it is. And it is so true that if we don't see that as a problem that was happening to our youth, as all of us as a citizen of the country, then we're never going to move forward. And so I'm so glad that you said that, and I'm so glad for all the people that are here, because I believe that that will begin a conversation even more with other people as well. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you for that. I'll tell you, you honor me, and I cannot thank you enough for having me today. Thank you for this wonderful evening. Thank you. Thank you.